Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you what SpaceX is doing very differently with Starships in Boca Chica than we all expected and why.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. And as always, there has been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in.
Starship updates.
As we all know from the last episode, SpaceX is entering the flight phase of their prototyping in Boca Chica, Texas. Starships will fly more frequent and we're in for a heck of a show even this year. Maybe, just maybe, even an orbital flight. But there's one thing SpaceX is doing very differently than we all expected. First though, let's take another one of those awesome bird's eye views of what's happening at the Starship construction site in Boca Chica, Texas. Mauricio from RGB Aerial Photography was on site again. If you have a coin to spare, I'd like you to pause my video for a second, head on over to RGB's Patreon page and sign up. Even if it's on the lowest level, it will help him immensely to fund more and better flights with even better camera equipment. Link, as always, in the description. His camera has captured the mind-boggling progress in Boca Chica once more. If you don't know what you're looking at here because you're a first-time viewer of my channel, this is where SpaceX is running their next-generation launch vehicle test program right now. Even though Falcon 9 rockets are the pinnacle of today's space launch industry, SpaceX does not want to settle down and enjoy the achievement of a self-landing orbital rocket booster. SpaceX and Elon Musk want more. They want to send humans to Mars, revolutionize how we use space and get us to the next level. Something that's never been here before. A fully reusable launch system, a true heavy lifter for an extremely low price. A Starship. Rapidly growing in the South Texan sun, Boca Chica has quickly turned into a large and complex site with large construction tents, high bays protecting prototypes from the environments, and lots of prototype parts all over the place. And every time we get new pictures, new land is being prepared for even more construction. Right now, SpaceX is working on several spots. Up by the shoreline, SpaceX is preparing a piece of land which could fit yet another construction tent or maybe a maintenance building. Technically, all the way to the new and fast-growing high bay, nothing is used for a building yet, and I wouldn't be surprised if the site looks very different in a couple of months. SpaceX intends to build super heavy boosters here rather soon. A super heavy booster is around 70 meters tall when finished and thus much larger than a Starship prototype. This will need many more ring segments, tank parts, bulkheads, you know, the usual Starship stuff. Stainless steel all over the place. More terrain grading is being done by the roadside. Where before cars were parked in the dirt, SpaceX is now working on turning the dirt patches into properly paved surfaces. The workforce in Boca Chica has been constantly growing to meet SpaceX's demand, and so even the two new parking lots were not able to compensate for the increasing number of cars. And this might be the solution. A parking strip, then a ditch, and maybe some trees to lighten up the scenery a bit. While workers are busy making the complex larger and larger on the outskirts, the high bay in the center is growing larger every day. Musk stated that in the end it will need to be 81 meters tall. While it's really hard to say how many more levels will be put on top, my guess is two more than what you can see here. Carlos from ICANimagine, together with Space Intelligence, has taken a beautiful shot from the ground showing the latest high bay progress. From this perspective, it is much easier to see the true size of the building. Now imagine a super heavy prototype rolling out of it. Mind-blowing. Go check out Carlos's Twitter for some amazing art shots of SpaceX in Boca Chica. Link is in the description. For those who do not know, this is where SpaceX workers are concentrating on the uppermost part of a Starship prototype. Nose cone and fairing. Here we can find all sorts of Starship noses, all of them slightly different. The one sitting in the low bay right now might be used for serial number 8, the latest prototype in construction. The one in front of it seems to be more advanced though, with RCS thruster openings and recessed grooves for forward flap mounting. The one to the left of the low bay has recently been polished, as you can see from the white coating. And in the middle of all those noses, we can see another three-ring segment with some interesting features to it. It has 5 large holes unevenly placed in it and some structural bracing on the inside. I've been thinking about this one for a while now. Those holes could either be for flap actuator installations or for stronger RCS thrusters, maybe a combination of both. And then there's one more very interesting thing to point out here. The forward flaps on the ground, still waiting for installation. Those are not the only aerodynamic surfaces on site though. Behind the Mark 1 nose cone, right next to the empty jig, I was able to spot parts that very much look like some aerodynamic covers. There are only three of them outside, but from the shape of it, they could be for forward flaps. It does look like they were shipped in wooden crates. And we can find those all over the area. So assuming all those crates are filled with special hull parts, all the parts needed for serial number 8 could already be on site. And that next big Starship is being constructed rapidly right now. Welcome to another installment of our famous progress animation for Starship prototypes, made together with Nick Henning. This is where I show the progress already made on the next Starship prototype, as it's super easy to lose track with all those different segments in different locations. The star this time, serial number 8. So how far along is it? We have the engine skirt, which goes in first. We also have a thrust section for serial number 8, including thrust park, thrust dome and skirt, which goes here. We also have the lower part of the oxygen tank, which is already sitting in the mid bay waiting for the stack, and it goes here. And we also have the common dome section, including the lower header tank, which goes here. Finishing off the tank stack, we have the top bulkhead sealing off the methane tank, and it goes here. This is where all the other serial numbers stopped. Not so with serial number 8 though. We have a full nose cone sitting in the low bay, which could already be for serial number 8, and it goes here. Finally, we also have both pairs of flaps. Aft flaps, which will go here, and recently delivered forward flaps, which of course will be mounted on the side of the nose. This is it, the first Starship to be fully assembled since Starship Mark 1. Now let's tackle the question I raised at the beginning of today's episode. I'll explain to you what SpaceX is doing very differently in Boca Chica than we all expected and why. This is Mauricio's latest flyby of the Boca Chica launch site. Looks just like always, right? We have the tank farm used to fill up prototypes for pressure tests and launches. We have the test stand on which many Starships exploded, collapsed, imploded and recently even flew. Then we have the landing pad. Both Starhopper and Starship serial number 5 used it to get down safely. And last but not least, we had the heavily talked about super heavy launch pad. We've closely been following the building process for a while now. After all, this is where Starships will take off towards Mars, right? 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 Well, let me tell you something about launch pads. When a rocket launches, in particular a large one, tremendous amounts of heat and noise are being produced. These normally are vented downwards through holes in the launch pad and then redirected sidewards through so-called flame trenches away from the pad. What you're looking at here, of course, is a Saturn V launch. 35 meganewtons of thrust, an unbelievable amount of force, heat and noise. As unbelievable as it might seem, SpaceX will dwarf Saturn V. A super heavy booster at liftoff will produce 72 meganewtons of thrust, more than double the heat and noise of what Saturn V blasted out. To reduce the impact of all this heat and noise to the surrounding environment, a so-called water deluge system is used. It spills hundreds of tons of water directly into the flame trench. When the exhaust gas carrying all the heat and noise hits the water, every little drop of it acts like a heat and shock absorber. In fact, water is an incredibly good heat and shock absorber. It has high inertia and evaporates quickly when heated up. What comes out of the flame trench on the other side is a big cloud of white steam. Most of the shock waves are absorbed and the heat is spread out evenly, stored inside the water vapor. All this water comes from a large water tower. Besides extremely powerful pumps, this is the only solution to feed such a system with the needed amount of water in such a short time. So we can find these very large water towers at all sorts of launch pads all around the world. They are a fixed part of launch complexes capable of launching large rockets. Yes, they are. Liked the update so far? Then click the like button, subscribe to the channel and maybe even consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Link is in the description. The team is working relentlessly to provide you with updates twice a week thanks to SpaceX's mind-boggling speed, and with your support it will be much easier in the future. Thank you. Now let's take a look at our Super Heavy launch pad again. Yeah, you're seeing it too, right? Even though the foundation driven down into the muddy soil close to the Boca Chica beach is extremely strong, and even though lots and lots of concrete has been used so far, I am telling you that this is not a launch pad at all. This is a water tower. A huge one too. And it would make sense too. Bear with me here, I have compelling arguments. Remember the 72 mega newtons of thrust? If SpaceX doesn't want every super heavy launch to completely destroy every structure around the pad, they will have to have a gigantic deluge system. Musk already spoke of sea launches for Starships several times in the past. This is the reason. The shockwaves and heat produced by a fully built super heavy are so immense that a land-based launch will require extraordinary measures. And SpaceX will have to test on land in the beginning. That's why we are looking at one of the largest water tower foundations in the launch industry being built in Boca Chica, Texas right now. Caspar Stanley and I have been thinking together, and here's what we came up with. We compared it to SpaceX's water tower at Pad 39A for scale to give a better reference, and that one holds a whopping 1.1 million liters of water for a maximum of 27 Merlin engines. And these are our ideas. Extremely beefy struts to keep the extra large water tank up in the air. These tanks can have a weight of thousands of tons on large water towers. No plumbing in the foundation needed either. Same as at Kennedy Space Center. A high water table makes plumbing in the ground difficult, so the huge outlet pipes normally are just laying above ground. Angled struts to make it structurally stable as seen in RGV's latest pictures. The large gray pipes from RGV's pictures as a center pipe and the small brown one in the middle of the foundation right now just as a structural support. We worked on a few different concepts to explain the angle of the beams. It could well be that the angle is not continued like this all the way up and that SpaceX is just building it like this as the ground in Boca Chica needs a large foundation. Water towers at Kennedy Space Center, for example, are built on limestone. It's not perfect as a foundation, but much better than mud. What's your opinion? Are we on the right track here? As always, tell me in the comments. And make sure to follow Caspar Stanley on Twitter and go check out his Patreon. He's working on an awesome rocket simulator worth every penny of support, links in the description. Another indicator for large plumbing needed at the site is this picture from RGV Aerial Photography and Mauricio's flyby from July 20th. Remember the large bent pipes? Those would fit a plumbing needed for such a water tower. But if what we're seeing built here is a water tower, where will the actual pad be? Most of us know this animation, but why on earth, pun intended, didn't we look at it in detail before? I mean, SpaceX kind of shows us that what they are building on the other side of this camera angle can't be the pad, right? According to the official animation, and that's as close as it gets to an official confirmation directly from SpaceX, the launch structure will be right next to the landing pad. There is no official information yet, and we might just have to wait and see if the construction site turns into the gateway to Mars or a needed extra to be able to launch in the first place. But right now, I am 100% Team Water Tower. Besides all the construction going on, SpaceX of course is working on getting the next prototype into the air. Serial number 6 is going through its paces to prove it's flight worthy. On August 16th, SpaceX's latest prototype, Starship Serial No. 6, passed the first test on the way to another 150-meter hop. Cryogenic proof testing was performed and everything went exceptionally well. I don't want to jinx this, but it looks like SpaceX is past all those repeating RUD events they encountered on prior prototypes. If this is true, we should be in for lots and lots of flight action in the coming weeks. This would mean for SpaceX that data is generated in huge amounts. This is exactly what's needed right now and on the way to a 20-kilometer flight. As of recording this episode, there was no new information on if Serial number 6 would receive 3 Raptor engines instead of just 1, but either way, another hop is needed to validate the system further. It's safe to say that SpaceX is writing history here. Something like what they're achieving in Boca Chica has last been seen in the late 50s and early 60s in the space race, and last time it led to us leaving a footprint on the moon. I am pretty sure that I am not alone in saying that we're all more than ready for the next footprints out there. Today's Patreon and YouTube member shoutout goes to Alfred Randall, Pascal Russ, Luke Bowers, David Konechny, Philip Haugtelin, he's patron number 500, Carolyn Blake, Jeffrey Cutler, and many others. You rock! We hit 500 patrons and we're now at 223 YouTube members. This is a small village of people getting together from all around the world to support our work. I don't know how I could possibly thank you enough for enabling me to do all this. You rock so much. I am missing the words thank you very, very much. And the last words of every episode always go to my team, a team which encourages me to go further every time. Making up the core of our community, they are willing to help with every step that I couldn't do on my own. Website, Discord, quality control, research, music, graphics. Thank you for doing this. Thank you for being such awesome people. You rock.
Ich weiß nicht, wo Mama ist. Das musst du wieder runterbringen. Du kannst sowieso die Würstchendose hier nicht rumschleppen.
He's carrying around a large can of sausages.
Du.
Deluge.
That's how it's done.